Okay, so the bad stuff happened in 2020, but along the way, you're working on, you ran on this idea of putting San Angelo businesses first.
Yes.
Right? Because you're a businesswoman, you've been here, you've financed other people going into business.
I have.
You've done a lot of that, so you have a sympathetic, empathetic ear toward small business.
Yes.
And so what have you, what has the city really done? I mean, seriously, from the trench warfare perspective, what has the city really done to increase the business activity and the opportunity for new business in San Angelo?
Number one, I always say leadership starts at the top, and you have to be able to project out there that San Angelo wants to support business and that we're business friendly and that you can come to us and have a conversation mm-hmm. with us, and we'll work with you to figure out how to get you in business or how to help you with whatever you're needing to do with your business. Because several years ago, San Angelo was not looked at as a business friendly city. In fact, many businesses looked at us and said, nah, not going there.
Well, I interviewed Billy DeWitt, a colleague on the council.
Yes,
she's
sir.
SMD 6. She said that she measures how well the city has done as far as building permits, mm-hmm. both commercial
correct.
And residential,
that's
but
correct.
Primarily probably the HBA is probably mm-hmm. the most vocal, and that's the Home Builders Association. She measures how well the city has done during her 4-year tenure
yes.
by how much her phone rang year one versus how much her phone is ringing
yeah.
about permits year four.
Yes.
And she says it is dramatically down. Now that's
correct.
An anecdotal thing. Do you have anything concrete to say that our permitting systems, our ease of doing business in San Angelo has gotten better under your tenure?
Absolutely, it's gotten better. If you just take a look at the number of houses that were built in 20 housing permits in 2019 versus 2020, it's doubled in amount.
Right.
So it says something. Obviously, if you can double the amount of housing permits, it tells you that the process has to have been simplified. But one of the tools that we used was this development task force.
Mm-hmm.
And that is a task force of builders who come together, both commercial and residential,
right.
and say, these are the things that we're frustrated with. These are the things that complicated. These are the things that need to be repaired, changed, ordinances, whatever they are. And we address those issues, but we did it from their perspective, not our perspective. So we allowed their voices to control what we needed to do in terms of making it simpler. But we also created an organization, a Development Review Committee, DRC, and it says to someone, if you've got a project idea, but you're not quite sure about some of the things that you might have to do or go through, you meet with the city officials anywhere from fire to electrical to, I mean, you name it, if you're going to have to use that service, plumbing, permitting, planning, and you sit in a meeting with these folks and you talk through your project. So before you ever make that decision, before you ever spend really a dime, if you will,
mm-hmm.
you understand what's going to be required, what the process is, what you need to do.
So if someone comes in with a crazy idea, they want to build some kind of commercial entity on things kind of maybe zoned multifamily residential,
yeah.
you explain to them, here are the risks,
mm-hmm. yes.
and what you have to do before they go spend
correct.
$300,000, you know, buying the property.
Yeah, and if there's some unusual thing about that project, it also gives city staff an opportunity to sort of do some research on what might need to be done based mm-hmm. off of the unusual circumstances. Not everything is black and white in development,
right.
depending on the land, depending on the project, depending mm-hmm. on the, you know, end use. So it's not black and white. We
right.
got to work through some of the details. And those are the things that really hang up more than
and
ever.
And you can add new procedures or new systems
yes.
based on how you're dealing with these one-off cases,
yeah.
I guess.
And we've done more electronic submittals, so you can submit your plan a lot electronically. Staff can communicate back to you. You don't have to get in your pickup, drive down to City Hall, sit and talk and go. So we've simplified it, and the same thing with inspections. Our inspectors have iPads, so when they go out to inspect, they've got something there that they can work with immediately to shorten the time frame,
mm-hmm.
etc. So like many businesses, we've become more electronic driven, simplify it. Communication is more straightforward. There's still some issues. I don't think there's going to be a day when we say we've corrected absolutely
right.
everything, but what we do have is a mayor who's business friendly, and if you have an issue, I talk to you, you call me, I talk to you, we work through it. And the same thing with our other city council members. We're here to make sure you have a success and have the opportunity to do business.
Okay. Let's talk more about business.
Okay.
What the heck are y'all doing downtown? You're tearing up Chadburn Street. And, you know, basically what I hear is, here is Mayor Gunter, this investor in downtown San Angelo, and she's using her position as mayor to build this gigantic, it's $20 million, right, the Chadburn Street project?
Well, it's approaching 20, but it is all the utility works.
But why are you doing it downtown? Okay. Why don't you fix Bell Street first? Why are you ignoring College Hills? Why are you ignoring my part of town, but you're doing all this nice stuff to downtown?
Number one, Bell Street will be completed by late this fall season. And when I ran for mayor, Bell Street was the constant thing. Bell
right.
Street, Bell Street, Bell Street. That's all you ever heard about. You didn't hear about College Hills. You heard about Bell Street.
Right.
Well, that project is ahead of plan. It's a $22.2 or $3 million project. Will be completed early, mm-hmm. so before the year ends. So that project is done. The other thing I heard all the time was at Avenue P, and those homeowners on Avenue P have dealt with flooding for 50 plus
right.
years.
And Avenue P is the neighborhood to the east of Bryant, down there by the water treatment
yes.
plant, actually, where it's part of the Red Arroyo floodplain. And so naturally, water runs off from all these parking lots
yes.
north of San Antonio. They're higher in elevation.
And runs, west of there.
And it runs down into this neighborhood and floods their homes.
Their homes have been flooded numerous times. Mm-hmm. So that project is underway as well. So the folks who live on Avenue P and Q deserved some response.
Mm-hmm.
And so the two things I heard the most were Bell Street and Avenue P.
Right.
They're being worked on.
Okay.
They're getting done.
All right.
So
you got those done. Now it's time to get downtown.
Well, what it is about, remember, Chadburn Street was 87.
U.S. 87,
it
the
was.
Highway,
it
north
It was state
south.
Highway.
Okay.
So, and it is also one of the oldest streets because downtown is the oldest part
right.
of town.
Right.
So it's a combination of some of the oldest water lines,
mm-hmm.
is oldest sewer lines, and Chadburn's pretty long. So you go from Avenue L, which is where the Chadburn Street project will ultimately start or
finish
take
up.
Care of,
yeah.
all the way up to the Coliseum.
Mm-hmm.
So when you talk about those numbers, that's a pretty long distance.
So it's not just downtown.
It's not just downtown. It is replacing all the water sewer from Avenue L all the way up to the Coliseum. It is doing the street work that's
But why
necessary.
Do we need this fancy star in the middle of the intersection?
I'll tell you why we need it. In 2007, there were three businesses that were open after the hour of 5 o'clock. Three.
In downtown?
In downtown.
What were they?
It was Fuente's, Blaine's Pub, and Miss Hattie's Restaurant.
Okay. So you had three restaurants. You had two restaurants and a bar.
Yes.
Open after 7 o'clock.
After 5 o'clock.
After 5 o'clock.
Yeah. So because retail closed between 5 and
right.
6 o'clock. All right. So that number one. Many people evaluate your city based off of what you do with your historic district.
Okay.
If it's a boarded up, ugly part of town.
Payday
that no
loan places.
Yep.
That kind of thing.
Pawn shops, things.
Mm-hmm.
People evaluate a city by whether they protect or care about the history of a city. It is the living room of the city. It is the heartbeat of the city. And when I say that, I say it for the following reasons. Shannon Hospital would have a very difficult time recruiting doctors, physicians, nurse practitioners, and their wives or their husbands if we didn't do the downtown redevelopment. Because they look at it as just a city with a lot of big box, just like every other city in America.
Everyone has a Best Buy. Everyone has three Walmarts.
They do. And so they want an entertainment district. They want a place where they can park a car, go have some dinner, listen to some live entertainment, go have a drink afterwards. They want an entertainment district, and that's really what downtown has become. It also has become, and the same thing if you talk about ASU.
Mm-hmm.
ASU recruits professors from all over the country. They need to be able to see that we have and we care about our city, and we're going to offer them also something in quality of life.
Mm-hmm.
It is an area that today, after the hour of 5 o'clock or 6 o'clock, you've got almost 30 businesses open. There's a dynamic difference in downtown. And it offers a quality of life not only for visitors, but residents.
But let me ask you this. This is a very personal question. What I mean, your husband,
Yes.
Ken Gunter.
Yes.
And you invested all this money in all these dilapidated buildings downtown, mm-hmm. right? Back
yes.
In, back in 1984 or whatever.
73.
73?
I wasn't here then.
You weren't there. But what got into you to do it? Because back then, I remember downtowns back mm-hmm. then. I mean, they were dying. You had
dying.
You know, you had homeless people,
yeah.
you know, defecating on the streets and things like that. They weren't considered safe.
Correct.
Why? What is the spark that started that back in the 80s?
Kenneth feared losing downtown. The city thought the only way to really get that part of town into redevelopment mode was to knock down all the old buildings and haul them out to the city dump. Kenneth was born and raised here. His family businesses were here. Gunter Wholesale, Gunter laid the cable. My husband laid the cable, created the original cable company here.
So you, so the cable company today is Suddenly, so blame Gunter for that too.
He sold it. We sold it.
Yeah.
But he saw it and said, you know, we lose, and he had traveled to a lot of areas. He was very instrumental in, for example, putting in cable in Aspen, Colorado. Mm-hmm. And he said they had all these old buildings that they had renovated into bars and restaurants, and he saw what was happening there. And as he traveled across the United States, because they had cable systems everywhere, he saw what people were doing, and he said, we can't lose our historic downtown. So he bought 12 buildings and started the restoration preservation of downtown.
Which at that time was buy, preserve, and hold.
You
pretty much couldn't do anything with it.
No, and he did start leasing out the buildings, but he was also doing a lot of development in other communities. Mm-hmm. So we leased him out a lot, and then we married, and he's like, you know, the only way downtown will really start to develop if we have a much nicer restaurant and have a reason.
And that was your cue.
Yeah, and he said, and I've married you, and that's going to be your job from now on. So Miss Hattie's became my responsibility when I moved here and worked hard to ensure that we had, if you will, as in the malls, you have a key anchor. Mm-hmm. And so Miss Hattie's was like a key anchor in that part of town.
And when did you open Miss Hattie's, or when was it open?
We opened it in September of 1998.
Okay, so about the same time you had that old Blaine Martin on the other side of town renting out the place from the... and starting Blaine's Pub.
Correct.
And the interesting thing about this is the entrepreneurial, I'm running too long. He's stretching.
We're talking a lot.
Anyway, the interesting thing about this is the entrepreneurial sparks that were, you know, it's kind of like trying to start a lawnmower mm-hmm. engine. But one of the, your advertising agent, Stephen McLaughlin, told this to me. And I thought this is very interesting. And it's not to take away from what the Gunners did. But he said the biggest driver of economic development for San Angelo the last 20 years was Blaine Martin.
Could very well be. And,
and
you know what?
The reason was there was a place to go that had kind of a trendy Texas country music.
Entertainment.
And so all the ASU students, you know, say, okay, this is a cool town.
Yes.
I'll go to ASU.
Correct.
And so ASU starts growing, you know. And then that kind of led to more things, like you had Rex Rogers open the Dead Horse, because he said,
important.
He says, I hate country music. He didn't say it like that,
but
we need to have
other.
Some rock and roll.
Yeah.
And then we had the Cactus Guy.
Well, somebody very important we had when that was John Castillo, who opened up
Fat Boss Pub.
That was very instrumental in really helping that part of Chadburn. Between him and Rex Rogers were really instrumental
right.
in terms of coming up with an entertainment.
And then you had Fernando open up the Chad Tab across the street. And of course, John Fuentes has always been like anchor down there.
Well, that's my point. He Blaine Pubs and us. But I mean, you look at it, they were people who believed in it, but had to hold on for a pretty long period of time before it really started developing. Because if you look at Fat Boss's Pub and Rex Rogers, those were things that started happening in 2006
right.
in that era.
Mm-hmm.
So that was kind of the beginning.
And that was 15 years
yeah,
ago. You
think
believe
about
that was 15 years ago? It took that long.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden now it's the hottest thing ever. This is a pretty hot piece of real estate.
And you know what else happened in this state was everyone started talking about 6th Street in Austin.
Mm-hmm.
Always.
Everybody wants to replicate 6th Street.
Yeah. And right. so that's why Rex Rogers and his idea was, there's this other thing happening, and we think there's that opportunity here. And ASU students, to recruit them, they needed to know they had their own 6th Street, if you will. But mm-hmm. the other important thing that happened was in 2008, we had this big financial bust.
Mm-hmm.
And many people had worked for companies were laid off from companies, fired from companies, but might have had retirement plans, et cetera. And they said, you know what, I'm no longer going to count on a company for my job. I'm going to open up a business. And the gentleman who opened up 1933, has 1933 now, but that was one of the reasons he opened up a bar then. He said, when he opened up, and I forget what originally was called.
It was called Grinner's.
Grinner's, okay. So he opened up Grinner's saying, I'm going to be in charge. And so he then opened up his business. Downtown allows for an entrepreneurial creative spirit to come alive. And that's why we're successful downtown, is because you have lots of individuals who said, I've got an idea. And downtown today is so great in my mind because you have all of these different creative minds who've taken a risk and invested their money and need the support of the city of San Angelo.
And you can really think outside the box to do a business in downtown.
You can.
I mean, there's an ice cream shop down there.
Yes.
Who would ever think an ice cream shop downtown would
be
cool?
And they're busy all the time.
Right. And we have a brewery. Two breweries.
I mean, you look at Casual Pint, what a success story that is. So you look at it and you say, downtown is a spark that is needed for multiple reasons. And you want a pedestrian friendly, walk around, be safe, good lighting. I laugh, you know, I'm horrible at cliches, but there's that old thing, step on a crack, break your mother's back. Well, you could hardly walk down a sidewalk at downtown because they were so broken and so in bad shape. You had to really watch the ground in order to make sure you didn't trip and fall. It is the hub of tourism. We bring a lot of people into this city. But it's also the area that anchors the river, one of our greatest assets. It anchors the cultural district, the museum. It anchors Fort Concho. It anchors City Hall Auditorium, SAPAC. It is where the cultural universe exists in our city. So you look at all the different points that make up what downtown is. It is a vibrant light in this city.
So when you talk to your opponents, let's say, or people who would criticize, and there's a lot of people who criticize people for everything, especially if it's very visible. There's two. One is, we shouldn't be doing anything downtown. Let the businesses do it. That's the total, you know, conservative, you know, let them all flounder. But there really is a conflict of vision. I wrote about this three years ago. And I'm just gonna put it out there. It's interesting because the history of it, but Lee Pfluger has a vision, and there's kind of like the Gunter vision. I'm gonna distill this so that the audience understands.
There's not separate visions.
But yours is a grandiose $20 million Chadbourne Street project. A Pfluger vision would be to build a little park, like that pocket park, heritage park he built. Or he likes to build small, plant small little seeds here and there. But this Chadbourne Street thing is a huge vision that you have.
Yes, and what people need to understand is that many of the funds that were used for this project are funds that could not be used for any other project, College Hills, Bell Street, or any other project. It's a combination of a grant from TxDOT.
Okay.
It is a combination of the TIERS fund, which my husband and I financed so that the TIERS fund could get created.
So TIERS is the tax investment.
Increment refinance zone.
There you go. And what that is, the property tax from the property owner goes back into this fund to reinvest.
Only the increase in value.
Increase in value. So you build this road, increases the value, that's going to increase some revenue to the city.
Well, as long as it impacts businesses and it makes more people come down and improve the businesses.
All right, so this $20 million bucks, we're not spending, the city didn't go out and get a $20 million loan to build this.
No, and also COSA-C, which is the City of San Angelo's Development Corporation, there's funds there for community projects. We've used funds from them. And so if you take a look at it, the only thing the city's paying for is really the water sewer lines.
Which you don't have to pay for anyway. Eventually.
Nobody does.
Right.
I mean, you don't do that if we redo the College Hills water and sewer line. The citizens aren't in that same vein picking up that, right?
Right.
So, and then the same thing with the street. The street work, no resident in College Hills is paying for the street work that will be done there. So those are things that are the responsibility of city. And that is one of the oldest streets, and also the Coliseum. If you drive up North Chadron right now,
everyone's going to the rodeo.
They're going to the rodeo, and it is a tough thing to drive that because it's in bad shape.
Bell Street version 2.0.
Yeah. So we want to make sure that rodeo, which is hugely important to this city, that street is part of this project. So yes, we're getting a lot of attention on the part that's being done now, but it's a big project. Mm-hmm. It's a massive project.
Why the stars?
Because it's what we call streetscape. If you go to any city that has pride in their historic downtown areas, they have a program called streetscape. It's improved lighting. It is mm-hmm. plants. It adds a little more decor, like you do in your living room.
Right.
It is embracing and adding some dimension.
So someone who doesn't want stars in there probably doesn't want pictures on the wall in their living room.
That could be the same. Glad you said it, not me. Yeah.
All right.